that did you come right to Detroit then? And you always had your headquarters in Detroit?
I came to Danbury, Connecticut, to Connecticut State first. I stayed 2-3 years and moved to Detroit. And since 1915, I am in Detroit.
Over there, over there. Send the word over there. That the Yanks are coming, the Yanks are coming. The drum, drum coming everywhere. So prepare, say a prayer. Send the word to beware. We'll be over, we're coming over. And we won't come back till it's over, over there.
Built a railroad, I made it run, made it race against time. Once I built a railroad, now it's done. Brother, can you spare a dime?
Do you worship Mohammed or do you follow Mohammed, sir?
We worship God only. No one else, no prophet, no angel, no any other great thing deserves to be worshipped but God, which we call Allah.
Allah, one God.
One God for all. And Muslim God is God all the universe, no doubt.
Oh, I'm putting on the top hat, tying up a white tie, brushing off my tail. I'm building up my shirt front, putting in the shirt
that. Little bluebirds fly beyond the rainbow. Why, oh, why can't I?
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy.
There'll be bluebirds over the white cliffs of Dover tomorrow. Just you wait and see. There'll be love and laughter and peace ever after tomorrow when the world is free.
shall be the policy of this nation to regard any nuclear missile launched from Cuba against any nation in the Western Hemisphere as an attack by the Soviet Union on the United States, requiring a full retaliatory response upon the Soviet Union.
Will you all rise, please? All right, now if you would join me in the singing of the Star-Spangled Banner, please.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so bright?
You cannot honor one person such as Reverend Crewe, my father, without honoring along with him all of those who forged the path through the wilderness that was the United States of America at the turn of the century. Most of these immigrants, like my father and like the Reverend Imam Khalil Bazzi, faced in this new nation here to them, sometimes hostility, open hostility. But on most occasions, they met the graciousness and kindness that is a symbol of the American people. I have had many occasions to sit and talk with these immigrants and discuss the stories. Each of them always has an interesting one, of how they came and how they forged their way through from city to city and town. But many of them with packs on their backs, actually, fearing nothing and not knowing the language, in fact, just by sign language, many of them, as Mr. Bashir Awed and many of them here, Mr. Wallach, I don't want to name many, but they are all present, I think, many of them are present here tonight, who would attest to that.
Today, on this 50th Jubilee celebration, we can all say with pride that Reverend Kharoob has stood the test of time. He has demonstrated his capacity to draw men of different races, creeds, and colors together in a spirit of peace and harmony. He has elevated to higher levels the ideal of service. He has promoted better understanding of the Muslim faith.
And so we honor him tonight. We want to give him the bouquets while he is still living, while he is still with us, while he is still able to appreciate them. And to you, my beloved Imam, I give you my congratulations. And I am sure I speak for everyone present, and I am sure that I speak for all of our Arabic-speaking people, in not only in this community, but throughout the length and breadth of this land, to thank you for the 50 years of service you have given religion and our people. We thank you for the character that you have built into our people, and we thank you for the contributions that you have helped our people make to this great America that we love so well.
consider, of course, that Islam is the culmination of the progression of the monotheistic faiths. It embraces the best of that which is in Judaism and in Christianity, and culminates with the message of Muhammad. And we ask peace and blessings on all of the prophets, and we make no distinction between them or among them in our faith. I hope I can have time for this. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَالَّذِينَ هَادُوا وَالصَّابِئُونَ وَالنَّصَارَى مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. Those who believe in the Quran, those who follow the Jewish scriptures, and the Sabians and the Christians, any who believe in God and the last day and work righteousness, on them shall be no fear, nor shall they grieve. Compare that, brothers and sisters of Christianity. Compare that, brothers and sisters of Judaism. Compare that, all my brothers and sisters, to that which is articulated and enunciated by some segments of the human race, some exclusivist religions who claim heaven as their private domain.
Many Islamic leaders are demanding the book be taken off the shelves and burned. They are demanding that the government of the United States burn the books, destroy them. At least 6 people have been killed in riots over satanic verses. How rarely does a book of fiction cause this kind of anger and hatred? It also reveals the chasm between some Western values, such as freedom of speech, freedom of the press, and the principles held as sacred by Muslims. On Upfront tonight, a man with a unique perspective on both. Iman Karu is not only an Islamic leader in this metropolitan area, but also a newspaper publisher, and he has his own radio show. Can you explain to the people at home, Mr. Karu, why there's been this incredible reaction to a human being with the leader of a government putting out a $2.5 million murder contract on his head? What has so outraged the Islamic world?
Well, primarily, Mr. Bonds, it would be that anything that fringes upon insult or vilification of the Prophet Muhammad, on whom be peace, would bring out this reaction, I think, naturally. And certainly every Muslim who honors and respects the Prophet Muhammad in a long line of succession, concluding all the prophets and messengers that preceded him, would react in this way. However, I would hurry to say, Mr. Bonds, that although we condemn the book, we condemn any insult or vilification of this prophet, the Prophet Muhammad in this case, or any preceding prophet or messenger, we quickly add that we also certainly do not call for any execution or murder of anyone on the face of the earth. Every person should be afforded legal counsel and a judicial tenure and trial.
Mr. Karu, do you then publicly condemn what the Ayatollah has done, putting out a contract on this author?
I not only condemn it, Mr. Bonds, I would go further and say that I am not sure if it's authentic, because I believe that Imam Ayatollah Khomeini knows very well, much more than I do, that we don't practice that kind of treachery or that kind of execution under Islamic law. It is a just law. It is a God-given, divinely revealed law. And every human being is dear and precious to the Maker, to the Creator of us all.
But do you believe, as the Ayatollah has said, and as some Islamic leaders have said, that there are squads out to murder this guy in England, this
office? No, I really highly doubt that last part, Mr. Uh-huh. Bonds. I don't believe that there are any squads out, although I would I wouldn't blame Mr. Rushdie, Salman Rushdie, that author, for hiding or for taking precautionary measures. But I certainly don't believe anyone, Iranian or non-Iranian, would constitute any kind of a hit.
Given the zealotry, and I don't have to tell you how passionate religious beliefs are in the Middle East. They're very, very passionate. I mean, people believe in holy wars. People believe that they're doing things for Allah and for Muhammad, and that to be killed in battle is a great reward. Is there any doubt in your mind that with this story out, that this author someday is a dead duck, that somebody's going to bump him off?
Well, there may be, there is some doubt.
Well, you laugh about it, but...
Well, I know I am taking your question seriously. However, death is not the answer to this man. I believe that we, as Americans primarily, and those of us who practice the Islamic faith, might do well to ignore this literary effort, if that's what we want to call it, and to let it suffer because it is extremely, Mr. Barnes, I want to tell you something, it is an extremely boring book. The parts I have read of it, they sent me a copy for review about a year ago, and I don't think any person could stand to read that book entirely. He might read a page or two and then set it aside.
But isn't it true in the Islamic religion, Mr. Carew, that women have to walk around with masks over their face, that you can't drink, you can't smoke, you can't dance, you can't listen to rock and roll, that you have to do everything? I'm from a Christian nation. I'm Christian. Why is this religion so intense? I mean, do the Islamic, those people who believe in Islam, think that theirs is the only true religion?
No, they certainly do not. We don't have time, I don't think, to go into it in depth. But Islam respects and reveres the monotheistic faiths and considers the followers of Judaism and the followers of Christianity as brothers and sisters under the one true God of us all.
Read this so that it is presented in memoriam to Imam Muhammad Carew by Governor Mrs. John Engler in recognition of the significant contributions made to strengthening the faith of the people of Michigan. It was dated for the 3rd of January, which is the day we present this, but please let me present this.
We will now receive the benediction from Imam Muhammad Carew from the Islam Federation of North America.
In the name of God, the beneficent, the merciful. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. All praise to Almighty God. All praise to Almighty God. All praise to Almighty God. And peace and blessings on all of those prophets and all of those messengers whom he did select
and Jews to represent his divine message to recalcitrant mankind. He has said on the lips of those prophets and messengers, I am the creator. I am the creator of the black and the white and the red and the yellow and the brown. I make no distinction among my creation, respecting only the good deeds that they accrue during their allotted time on earth. I ask in benediction to Almighty God, without intercession, that those who have gathered here on this historic occasion to honor one from among us, one of God's chosen servants, who is known on this earth and to our hearts in affection as Sophie, who is known as Jimin and William, but to God Almighty, may his name be everlastingly praised, he is known as servant of God. Almighty God, our Lord, accept the good deeds that Mr. Williams has done in thy behalf, that those who follow of righteous males and righteous females emulate the fine example that he has dedicated and delineated for us to follow, Almighty God. Bless our leaders, male and female, that we may find in them the spirit of Almighty God guiding them to ever greater achievement. And I ask Almighty God humbly from my heart that you extend the lives of these good people, principally the lives of Jimin and William, his wife, our sister, and his good family, and seed of his seed. Bless those who have gathered here, Almighty God, male and female. Let bask in the sunshine, Almighty God, literally of this day, and figuratively, Almighty God, the sunshine of thy scriptures. Almighty God, let them recognize, one and all, that God does not change the condition within a people until that people changes the condition within themselves. Almighty God, our Lord, we turn our hearts and our faces to thee. In Almighty God, in liberty and supplication, asking thy blessings, Almighty God, asking thy blessings, Almighty God, asking thy blessings, Almighty God, on this creation, Almighty God, amen.
Thank you all so much for coming. We are adjourned.
The white cliffs of Dover tomorrow.